Hi folks, Will from MinIO here, and in this video, I'm going to be talking to you about object replication. Object replication can be used for disaster recovery. You can also use it to take your data and migrate it to different servers around the world in case you need to have data locality. It's a really powerful tool, and it's actually fairly easy to set up. So let's go ahead and dive right into some slides. So in our video, we're going to talk first about bucket replication, which is a more simple way to set up replication on an already running server. And we're also going to be talking about site replication, which is going to allow you to replicate an entire site, including all of the buckets, including security settings and things of that nature. So let's start off talking about bucket replication. Bucket replication can be used to replicate data that already exists on your server. It's very easy to set up between two different servers. Let's take a look. First off, I should mention that there is a separate tool called mcmirror, which is part of the MinIO command line tools. This can actually be used to do replication of a bucket very, very easily. It actually works outside of MinIO and can work between various S3 compatible servers. You don't have to have MinIO on both ends. The only issue with mcmirror is that when you're doing an mcmirror, let's say you're trying to replicate data from San Francisco to New York. If you're doing an mcmirror and you happen to be living in Texas or Omaha or wherever, what's going to happen is mcmirror is going to download that object to your local system and then upload that object to your other system in New York. So there's an extra step involved. If you are using server-side replication, however, San Francisco and New York are just going to talk to each other without any intermediary steps. This also replicates extended features like versions and etags, which is something you're not going to get with mcmirror. Now, in order to do this, you have to have MinIO on all your participating servers, however. When you're setting up bucket replication, you can have one of three modes. Active-passive, which has a main bucket that then replicates its data down to a secondary bucket. The secondary bucket is passive. You're not going to upload anything to that bucket. And anything that you put in that bucket, should you put anything there, is not going to get replicated back to the main bucket. On the other hand, you can have active-active replication, which allows replication to happen in both directions. If you have a bucket in New York that has active replication set up pointing to a bucket in San Francisco, and that same bucket in San Francisco is pointing back to New York, then anything that you upload to either New York or San Francisco will automatically get replicated. Now, that said, you may be thinking, well, this is going to introduce an infinite loop because I'm just going to be replicating stuff back and forth. Not true. We actually have that problem solved, and you'll see that when we do our demo. There is also a way to set up multi-site active-active. So let's introduce a third server in Dallas. This way I can set up replication between New York, San Francisco, and Dallas, and have all of that replication work very, very cleanly. And we'll show you an example of that in just a few slides. In order to enable replication, however, your bucket has to have versioning enabled. If I'm doing bucket replication, I need to make sure that I've enabled that replication on the bucket. If I'm doing site replication, bucket versioning becomes the default, so there's no way to create a bucket that doesn't have versioning anyway. But that's only for site replication. When you are doing versioning replication, obviously one of the things that can get replicated is delete markers. Now, we'll see a little bit later, but you can change what gets replicated by using the replicate flag on the mcreplicate command. We'll talk about that in a little more detail. If you have retention enabled, you can replicate object locks. This includes all the metadata, like the duration, the type, if I'm doing a legal hold, or et cetera. All participating buckets have to have locking enabled. They need to have the same locking policies as well. It is not a requirement to have retention enabled in order to do replication. The two are independent, but they do work together. When you are doing replication, both ends of the replication have certain permissions that are required so that replication can function. Now, these are very complicated permissions. A lot of people will just kind of try to bypass it and go with something like a full read-write or something like that. You don't want to do that. There are some very clear, defined permissions that you need. We have it in our documentation. You can set these up very easily with mcadmin. I highly recommend using just the permissions you need for the user that's going to be doing the replication or managing your replication processes. When I am setting up active-passive replication, it's very easy. I simply do an mcreplicate. This replicate command can take an add or an update, whatever I need to do here. And I'm going to do a replicate add in this case. I'm adding to my local bucket a pointer to this remote bucket. Now, the remote bucket, I have to define with HTTPS. I have to give it the user, the password, the host, the port, and the bucket name. I have to give it that fully qualified domain name. I have to give it the full URL of what I'm going to be replicating to. Now, the reason for this, the reason why I can't just use an alias here, is because in this case, I'm telling the bucket where it's replicating to. And the bucket doesn't really know anything about the alias, so I have to give it the full details. I'm telling it also that I want to replicate existing objects. There's a whole list of different flags you can hand to replicate. Take a look at our documentation for that. But this sets up active passive replication. Now, anything that I deposit into my local bucket, those objects will be replicated to my remote bucket. To do an active setup, it's literally just one more step. I need to just reverse the endpoints that you saw before and point the remote bucket back to the local bucket. I can just use the same command. Multi-site is going to create a mesh of these active pairs, but it does rapidly become complicated to keep track of it. Diagrams can help. Let me show you a simple one here. So let's say I have three servers, MinIO 1, MinIO 2, MinIO 3, and each of them is going to need to have two replication rules for the bucket. Okay. So my bucket that is on MinIO 1, if I want to replicate it to MinIO 2, I need to have a replication rule replicating it to MinIO 2 and a replication rule replicating it to MinIO 3. Similarly, MinIO 2 has to have the same thing. Basically, what it comes down to is you have a lot of rules you're going to have to write for this. So that is how you set up multi-site active bucket replication. If you have an error, you need to restore a bucket from a replica, you can use the MC replicate resync. Now that MC replicate resync is going to take a little time. You can monitor its status with the resync status. Note, if the bucket that was destroyed or the bucket that was lost also lost all of its replication rules, you have to recreate those manually. So if I have a multi-site and the bucket on MinIO 1 goes down and I can't get the replication rules back, I'm going to have to recreate all the rules that I had there. We're going to take a break right here. In our next video, we're going to discuss site replication. I hope you've enjoyed the video so far. If you'd like to reach out with us, you can communicate with us with any of the methods you see here on the screen. You can also Slack us on slack.min.io, or you can just leave a comment here on the video. Thanks, and we'll see you for the next one.